we want to thank everyone for taking the trip out from around the world across the USA. We know there are lots of meetings that you can go to and lots of choices and options, so it's really everyone's willingness to come out to the Cold Spring Harbor meeting that makes it so special, but allows us to do this every other year. And what we really want to do before we get too far along is thank our sponsors, so the guys paying the bill. So the meeting was supported by Cell Microsystems and Protein Simple, Takero Bio and 10X Genomics as the major supporters, but also Regeneron as a benefactor, and then other sponsors are Agilent, Bristol-Myers Squibb, Calico, Celgene, Genentech, Thermo Fisher, Merck, Monsanto, New England Biolabs, Pfizer. Ooh, we even have a real estate company, Alexandria Real Estate, so there must be some single-cell real estate out there. Gilead, Novartis, and then Sanofi. So I think that kind of signifies the popularity of all the single-cell technologies and how it's becoming pretty exciting and revolutionary in the field of single cells. And now Scott is, he says he's got about an hour introduction for you guys. Hang in there and he'll finish up shortly.
Yeah, not really an hour, no longer than 45 minutes. Okay, so this is the fifth of our single cell meetings here in the US that's been held at Cold Spring Harbor Labs. In the alternating years, there's a meeting in Suzhou at Cold Spring Harbor Asia. So we'll put up the dates of that once we remember what they are on the board. So if people are interested in that meeting, they can go for it. It's also really helpful if people mention to the sponsors, if you do buy anything from them, that you would buy more if they gave more to the meeting. Whether or not it's true, you can say it. No. Okay, so how many people here, is this the first meeting you've gone to at Cold Spring Harbor? Okay, so look around you. There's a lot of us that are new to this, and the meeting has grown tremendously from what it was before. It started in a little upstairs room in the teaching lab space, and each year we've been increasing. It's not quite Moore's Law, but it's getting close. So eventually we'll take over Manhattan or something. What that means is that a lot of people here don't know the places, the important places. I'm assuming you all found the cafeteria already. Tomorrow at lunch, there's a downstairs eating spot as well as upstairs in case the lines get too long. And most important, underneath the lobby area outside the dining room is the bar. And I've discovered that most of the great scientific exchange happens in the bar. I can't remember what I talked about the next day, but it seemed great at the time. But it is a very nice place to meet up. And the tradition is that the keynote speaker treats everybody to their first drink.
I may
have made that one up. Okay. So we're very glad that we've got Ellen. Ellen has the support, actually, to buy everybody a drink, because a few years ago at Caltech, she won the Feynman Prize as the best Caltech professor. And so that's why we invited her to come here, because she's been a great speaker and has really pushed forward the area that we're all talking about and its applications. So Ellen started life, well, didn't start life. She, as a grad student, she was at Harvard, if I remember. Oh no, an undergrad, you're Harvard. Then a grad student for a while in the HST program. Then she realized that if she graduated, she'd have to become a medic. And you bailed, right?
Early,
okay. And then became a grad student with David Baltimore working on RNA viruses, if I remember the history right. After she finished there, she did some postdoctoral time and some faculty time at Memorial Sloan Kettering, then at the Salk Institute. And then about 63 years ago, she started at Caltech as a faculty member. It was about the same year I started at Caltech, so I'm actually inaccurate on the time. But she's been there throughout her whole career. She now holds one of the chaired professors, as I mentioned, has been just amazing both in doing quantitative analyses and gene regulatory network analyses of systems, has advised the RIKEN and Max Planck Institute and a whole bunch of things. And I'm really glad she's here because a couple years ago, I jumped ship on Caltech, and so I haven't been able to hear Ellen as much as I used to. So we're very glad you're here. We're looking forward to your talk and dissecting the T cell. Although I thought your original thing was something about being employed as a T cell, or what was? But anyway, this will be great. So thank you, Ellen, for being here.
Thank you. That's a very sweet shot.
Yeah.
Can everyone hear me all right? Thank you very much. First of all, I just want to thank Scott immensely for inviting me to be a keynote speaker for this meeting. I'm thrilled to be here. This is my first single-cell meeting at Cold Spring Harbor. And it's also just a wonderful opportunity to see what you guys think about some of the work that we've been doing, where we feel that we're really learning things about the underlying mechanisms and biological processes that we would only be able to learn through use of single cell technologies. And my lab does its share of the 10 to the 6th, 10 to the 7th cell chip seq experiments. We do lots of genomics. We do a lot of inference of gene regulatory networks. But what I wanted to emphasize today are some insights into the way the decision-making process about cell fate works at the single cell level, sometimes at the single allele level. And so we'll talk about that, and I will be delighted to have feedback from you, positive or negative, at the end to see what you think. And I should say that Scott was an absolutely wonderful colleague of mine at Caltech, and I was very, very sorry when he stopped being at Caltech, where he could tell terrible jokes, but at the same time do inspirational and beautiful science. And so it's a great pleasure to be here. Okay, so I'm going to talk about T-cell development. And T-cell development is a field which to many people nowadays means how to get mature peripheral T-cells to work a little better in an immune response. But that's not what I mean. I'm really talking about developmental biology. That is, how a multipotent progenitor gets programmed to become a T-cell in the first place. It's basically like embryology, except that your body keeps on making more and more cohorts of T-cells throughout the first part of your life for many years. And we even people as old as I am, keep the ability to make T-cells further on down the line. Now, as a developmental system, it's very beautiful for single-cell analysis. It's extremely well-defined, and the T-cell development occurs not in the bone marrow with the other hematopoietic cells, but it actually requires emigration of multipotent cells from the bone marrow, still very immature, to the thymus, where all of their programming to become T-cells occurs. And so you have a much purer population. You have insight into transitional cells, with a great deal of work done to define the markers that prospectively tell you what status a cell has. And what we know about it is quite extensive. We know that it's a dynamic process that integrates microenvironmental signals, which involve the provision of ligands for notch signaling pathways and a specific set of cytokines that are helpful for T-cell development and starve to death any cell that's trying to do the wrong thing. And as I'm going to emphasize today, the process is driven by the programmed loss and gain of waves of transcription factors through transcriptional regulation of these transcription factor coding genes. And that's really going to be the crux of the talk. What I'm going to say is that some of these changes have to do with enhancesome-like assembly of transcription factors on regulatory elements in real time, where there's coincidence. But a lot of the surprising amount of this has to do with epigenetic chromatin changes that actually provide a kinetic barrier. And we're going to talk about that in some depth. because it's actually an unexpectedly strong effect. And we're going to talk also about the role of cell division, which might logically be involved in resetting the epigenetic marks because of the need to propagate them at every S phase. And so that's also a very interesting variable here. Now, just to give you a little bit of introduction, those of you who don't want to go into the field particularly, you don't need to memorize the markers, but you should know that we actually have named and classified, we as a field, have classified cells that go through a linear progression from multipotency to actual T-cell precursor function. We can tell them apart based on cell surface markers. I'll show you a little tiny bit of that. And we've named them mostly in numerical order, although the stages have been subdivided in important ways. The first cells in the thymus getting the bombardment of notch ligands to start them into this process are called ETPs, or Kit-high DN1s. They become DN2s. They then become DN3s and so forth. The interesting thing is the splits between DN2A and 2B and DN3A and DN3B actually turn out to be important. It turns out that this is when the cells experience their first test of whether or not they are on track to get a T cell receptor that will allow them to recognize antigen. And if they fail, they die at this point. If they succeed, they get a huge reward of a burst of proliferation, and they get to go on and continue assembling the T cell receptor. More recently, our lab discovered this split between DN2A and DN2B, which actually turns out to be enormously profound, because up until this point, if you take the cells out of the thymus and put them just in a neutral hematopoietic microenvironment, they will give rise to things other than T cells. But at this point, they no longer give rise to anything but T cells. So basically, all the other developmental options are closed off as the cells make this transition. Obviously, this is an important, interesting thing. This is when the cells, it's sort of like they incorporate the superego of the parental influence of the notch signaling, to go back to a sort of a pseudo-Freudian formulation. And the cells, after this point, don't need the notch anymore to tell them that they're going to be T cells, even though they still need it a little bit longer for viability. So what has been internalized? What's actually been changed? It's the regulatory machinery in the cells, and essentially we know a lot about the transcription factor expression patterns as the cells go through this process. You can basically break up the transcription factors that they express into two global groups, one which we're calling phase one factors that are basically propagating forward the legacy of the stem and progenitor cells that were multipotent but which also self-renewed. And this is continued for actually quite a while into the thymus, and it's succeeded by waves of transcription factors that are basically involved in giving the cells a T cell identity. And the big changeover is happening right exactly as the cells undergo commitment. And so basically these losses of function, or these shutoffs, and these onsets of expression are crucial for the commitment process to occur. Now, we can simplify this picture to look at just a few transcription factors, and I'm going to simplify it even further in a few minutes. But basically, we have the progenitor-like factors can be represented by ones like PU.1, which is a strong lineage-determining regulator of myeloid cells like macrophages and neutrophils, but it's also a multipotency factor. And it basically comes in very strongly expressed and then shuts off during commitment. Now, when the cells first come into the thymus, the notch signaling that they're getting through interaction with the environment causes them to upregulate some new transcription factors. And two very important ones are TCF1 and GATA3, and they collaborate with factors that were expressed before, like RUNX1. But this is not sufficient to give the cells commitment. The cells can still give rise to dendritic cells, myeloid cells, and NK cells all the way through this, despite the fact that they're expressing these other factors. What changes everything is when they turn on this transcription factor, BCL11B, which occurs just at the junction between DN2A and DN2B. And this turns out to be functionally a final rate-limiting mediator of commitment. And so what I'm going to do is essentially zero in on BCL11B and figure out what causes BCL11B to be turned on when it is, given that commitment can't occur without it, and once it is expressed, the cells are committed. So some crucial tools that we've developed over the years in our lab, Haoyuan Kuei, a wonderful postdoc at the time, developed a series of fluorescent protein knock-in reporters into the 3' untranslated region of the BCL11B locus. And this is in a non-conserved region, so it avoids all the microRNA targeting sites as well. And this expresses very faithfully exactly like normal BCL11B. Here you can see our main stage markers that distinguish ETPs, DN2As, DN2Bs, DN3As, and then onward. And the BCL11B YFP fluorescence fits beautifully with the RNA expression levels that we can measure in these populations in bulk. You can see that essentially all of the cells from DN2B onward are uniformly high in BCL11B. This level in the ETPs is basically the same as background. But the interesting thing is the DN2As, which are bimodal, that's when BCL11B is turning on. And if we use the fluorescence to sort these cells based on whether they're in this group or that group, we can then put them into commitment assays, and we can find that these cells with the BCL11B beginning to come on are already committed. These cells in the same tiny population, but without BCL11B yet, are not committed. So this is really our best single cell marker for commitment status. And we know something about how BCL11B fits into the gene regulatory network for T cell development. This is a fairly broadly defined gene regulatory network without a lot of cis-trans detail. But essentially what we know is that BCL11B isn't turned on until this stage here, when it relies on inputs from other genes that have already been turned on, including GATA3 and TCF, first turned on by the Notch signaling, then establishing positive feedback circuitry with each other, starting to turn off subsets of these progenitor genes that are going to get silenced in collaboration with other factors that are stably expressed, and then BCL11B basically goes on, and now that flips the switch over completely, and the cells flip into this new state that they're going to maintain then for the duration. And so one of the points is that these required transcription factors that I'll show you some data for are actually already known to be turned on in the ETP cells. However, for BCL11B to go on takes at least a week and many cell divisions after this. And so there's a question here, which is really, why does commitment, why does BCL11B's activation and the commitment that follows from it, why does it take so long? If you have all of the regulatory inputs, what's holding it up? So I'm going to tell you something of this story right now, and you're going to see that this is actually, even though I've just distilled this whole commitment process down to one gene, we're going to see that just getting that gene expressed correctly takes a lot of regulatory machinery. So first, we have just simple AND logic involved, obviously. I mean, if you zoom out from the molecular details, this is obviously an AND logic situation. You need Notch signaling, you need TCF7, which is encoding TCF1. You need GATA3, you need RUNX1. And they're all required. If you knock out any of them, BCL11B doesn't go on. But the question is, how do they actually work? And can we use the tools that we have to tell us something about how they work? So it turns out that single-cell assays are beautiful for this, because the cells turn out to turn on BCL11B asynchronously. If you have a wave of cells that are in a similar developmental stage, and you put them into conditions in which they can turn on BCL11B, you'll see that they turn it on over a period of days, but individual cells will give rise to BCL11B positive cells with at different times. And so a really nice way to look at this is to actually image the onset of expression of BCL11B in individual cells. And we can do this because there's a marvelous experimental system for T-cell development in vitro. We didn't develop it, but we've used it a great deal. It was developed by Juan Carlos Zúñiga Fluker's lab in Toronto, and it's really transformed the T-cell development system into maybe one of the most accessible developmental systems in all of mammalian biology. And so you could basically put your any kind of multipotent hematopoietic precursor into a simple stromal co-culture system, and then you could just basically turn a camera on it and record what happens to the cells afterwards, and they go on and become T cells. And you can do flow cytometry, you could take the cells out of the culture and see what all of the other markers are and so forth. And by using the imaging, as I think many of you in this room are obviously aware, you watch the accumulation of the fluorescent protein from the tagged locus. It accumulates with a characteristic slope. That slope actually gives you the rate of transcription to a first approximation. And you know, each time the cell divides, it gets cut in half. But you can tell when the transcription rate is accelerated by the change in the slope. So you can ask questions like, what is the role of the notch signaling? This diagram here puts notch both as an input to BCL11B and as an input to other inputs. So is there actually any input into BCL11B that's direct as opposed to indirect? And one way we can ask this is we can purify the cells. These cells here, sorry about this, these cells here that are right on the cusp of turning on BCL11B, they're in the same stage of development as the first cells that will turn on BCL11B, but they haven't turned it on yet. And we can actually test whether it still makes a difference to have notch signaling. And we can do that by following individual cell trajectories and look at the fluorescent protein coming up. And what we can see is that at this point, even though the cells have GATA3 and TCF and RUNX, it still makes a difference whether you have notch signaling in there. And basically, you can see the BCL11B turning on with a couple of different slopes. There's this slope, and there's this slope, and there's the flat slope, which is that they haven't gotten around to turning it on yet at all, despite being exposed to this signal. And you can see that in the absence of the notch ligand, you see that almost all of the cells stay down here, although you'll notice that a few of them start turning BCL11B on anyway. And it turns out that both parts of this picture are important and true. One part is that the notch signaling obviously accelerates and enhances the likelihood of these cells turning on. But the other is that some cells will turn BCL11B without any more notch signaling. And once they have it on, I'm not showing you the data, but once they have it on, they don't care whether the notch signaling is completely removed and they never see it again. Once the gene is on, it doesn't need the notch signal at all anymore. So essentially, what you see is that there's a probabilistic enhancement of the onset of BCL11B expression based on notch signaling at this even at this very late stage. The other thing you can notice is, look, this is only one cell I'm showing you here, but as a general rule, the slopes of accumulation are the same for the cells that manage to turn on BCL11B in the absence and the presence of notch signaling. And that tells you that there's probably not anything that the notch signaling is doing to affect the amplitude of expression, simply the likelihood of expression. And that turns out to be very much borne out. So this is basically a probabilistic enhancer of BCL11B expression at this stage. Now, what about those transcription factor coding genes that are downstream from the notch signal themselves, but also have an input to BCL11B? And we're looking here at what happens when you knock out GATA3 or TCF. And this is an interesting result, which we did not expect at all. Because here, if you knock them down with shRNA in the ETP stage, the early DN1 stage, you see that it has a big effect on the likelihood that a cell will turn on BCL11B, individual cells. But if the, and these are different cultures, and so what I'm plotting is in the subculture, what's the fraction of cells that turn on BCL11B. But if you wait till the cells have already turned on BCL11B, they don't care whether GATA3 or TCF is there or not. They do not require it anymore to keep on sustaining the BCL11B expression they already have. And even if you look at those poised cells that were still making a quantitative response to the notch signal, most of them had absolutely no response whatsoever to the removal of GATA3. And they have a fairly wimpy response to the loss of TCF. So what we're seeing is this whole system is front-loaded. You need a lot of regulatory input. And I'm not showing it to you, but a much stronger effect of notch also in this early ETP stage, long before the gene actually itself comes on. You need notch and GATA3 and TCF at this point. But as you get closer to turning it on, you need less and less of that. And there's a question, which is that the three regulators I just told you about, which are the ones that depend on the thymic microenvironment to be provided, all of them are controlling the likelihood of expression, but they're having minimal effect on the amplitude of expression in cells that do manage to get the gene on. Where's the amplitude control coming from? Amplitude control is what we think about when we think about transcriptional regulation normally. We're thinking about what's the rate of recruitment of new Pol2 complexes to the promoter and allowing them to release and go down the DNA. That's an amplitude of expression. Who's controlling that? And it turns out that the one that's controlling it is the RUNX. And RUNX does control it. You can see that if you knock down RUNX, the whole population shifts to lower BCL11B expression. If you add RUNX, the whole population shifts to more BCL11B expression. This is where the amplitude control is coming from. And this is just talking about later T cells that do the same thing. So what I've told you is that we actually think that by following the fate of the BCL11B fluorescently tagged gene in these cells, we think we understand something about when the different regulatory inputs are required. And we know that there's a poised state that's set up by the required action of at least two transcription factors and additional notch signaling before the gene is actually eligible to go on at all. And that actually an early available regulator is playing a major role later on as the actual, the rheostat controller of the gene expression later on. So this is nice, and we published it a year and a half ago. And it's just, the nice thing about it is it tells you something about the fact that you can have AND logic that operates across time scales, and that essentially you have this requirement for joint action which combines immediate inputs with older inputs. But that's not really the story I want to tell you tonight. What I want to tell you is that this is an incomplete explanation for the regulation of this gene and the timing of commitment. And as I showed you, BCL11B doesn't come on until the cells are already in the DN2A stage, but all of these positive regulators are there beforehand, and many of them are exerting their powers beforehand. So what are we missing that explains the delay? And there are two kinds of classes of explanation that you can come up with immediately. One of them is additional factors that we didn't know about. Well, we've actually looked fairly broadly at the transcription factor coding genes in early T cell development, and it's not obvious what else comes on as a positive regulator candidate closer to the time of onset of BCL11B expression. One can play that game, one can look further. There's always a possibility that there's some splice isoform that has a special role, but it's not obvious. And so one way to ask the question is, well, is there another possible explanation at all? And yeah, there is. It's the possibility that it actually might take enough time to remove repressive epigenetic marks so that there may be actually an offset in when you see the BCL11B come on relative to when it is first programmed to go on. And is this even plausible? Well, first, at the ChIP-seq level, it's very plausible, because if you simply look at histone marks on the BCL11B locus, it's actually, and this is also true of DNA methylation, it turns out that if you look at the ETP stage, or DN1, DN2A, DN2B stages, and here's the RNA coming on, and this is the BCL11B coding exons themselves that were very zoomed out to show a megabase of DNA as the scale bar. Here's the BCL11B locus. You can see that the gene doesn't start to get transcribed until DN2A, then it comes blazing on at DN2B. And you can see that the epigenetic marks that are involved in accessibility of chromatin are basically stationed around this locus and through this gene desert downstream of it in the direction of transcription. But there's also repressive marks, which I'm not sure if you can see it very well, but there's actually a real mound of polycomb repressive complex 3 H3K27 trimethylation here on the whole front third of the BCL11B locus, including many of the regulatory elements near the promoter. And there's also a hump of it piled on this region right here in the middle of this gene desert, which I'll show you a little bit later on is a super enhancer for BCL11B. And that, in fact, these repressive marks actually have to get hollowed out in these regions, both around the gene itself and in this region here, at the time that the gene goes on. So how slow can this be? Now, there are two schools of thought about epigenetic marks or chromatin modifications. One of them is that epigenetic marks are completely dominant and that they determine gene expression completely. It's not clear how they know when they're supposed to be open and when they're supposed to be closed, but they dominate the world. The other philosophy is that epigenetic marks are basically just symptoms of transcription factor action because they're so easily changed. And we can see examples of both kinds of things possibly going on. So you can't say just from the change in these chromatin marks whether or not they're actually rate limiting for the activation of the gene, or whether they could possibly be rate limiting over the time scales that we're talking about, which is days, 4 cell divisions. But let's see. And one way that we can find out is we can ask whether or not we can pick up any noise in the activation kinetics of the two alleles in the same cell. The rationale here is that the transacting factors, I don't care how many transacting factors we might be missing in our knowledge so far, but what we know about transcription factors is they go on and off the DNA pretty fast. And there's no way for a transcription factor to be bound to one chromosome and not another at the same sequence unless there's a difference in accessibility between those two chromosomes. The transcription factor basically can go on and off. If it's in the cell, it has access to both chromosomes. If the histones state, the nucleosome packing, the DNA methylation are not barriers. But if they are barriers, then if there is a slow process of cis opening, then you can imagine through the kind of lateral reader-writer types of mechanisms that are known to operate in these systems, that they spread along the chromosome in cis. And you can imagine a scenario where one chromosome could get ahead of the other. The question, at least transiently, the question is, what are the time constants? Could they possibly be long enough to account for what we're talking about here? And so what Haoyuan Kui did was he basically made a second reporter strain in which M. cherry was knocked into the same place that YFP was knocked in the other strain, and bred the mice together. So we have two color mice where each of the alleles of BCL11B is tagged with a different fluorescent protein reporter. And then we simply asked, do they turn on at the same time as the cells go through the transition from off to on? And this is a very simple way to see the results without having to look at flow cytometry. If we sorted individual cells as clones into wells on OP9 stroma, the permissive stroma for T cell development, and they're all DN2A, BCL11B negative at the start of this culture, we let the clones recover from the sorting and then start dividing and then differentiate, and ask, in a clone, are all the cells expressing both colors? And here I false colored the YFP green so that you can actually see very vividly whether or not it's co-expressed with the red. And you can see that in about 30% of the clones, we got both of the alleles turned on simultaneously. But in at least an equal number of wells, we saw one or the other turn on significantly before the other. And significantly means 2 days before the other. So in the same individual clonal descendants of the same cell, you can have essentially a head start for the YFP or a head start for the M-Cherry before the other one comes on that lasts for days. Is this a tissue culture artifact? Is this a detection artifact? Are we frying the cells by looking at them under the microscope? What we can do is we can look in the thymocytes of a mouse that's made from these cells that have the red and the yellow colors knocked into the BCL11B locus. And we can look at the ETPs, DN2As, DN2Bs, and then onward. And you see the cells start out neither red positive nor yellow positive. They end up double positive for red and yellow. But the interesting stage is the DN2A stage when they're turning it on. And you can see that even in vivo, it's totally obvious that some of the cells turn on the red first and then the yellow, and others turn on the yellow first and then the red. And this is totally reproducible. So essentially, you can even see, if you look carefully, some cells that go through the rest of the developmental process still lagging behind. They have one allele perfectly well turned on, but they haven't quite gotten around to turning on the other. And I'm not going to show you the data, but it turns out there's a window of opportunity for getting this gene activated. And the window of opportunity is basically DN2A to DN3. And DN3 has a lot less chance anymore of activating a silent allele. So a copy of BCL11B that doesn't activate in one of these stages has a very high likelihood of being left off permanently. And you can find mature T cells floating around in the periphery of those animals, even becoming memory and effector cells that have only one copy of BCL11B turned on, even though they have two good copies. So is this regulated or is this just some kind of artifact? To check the regulation, we zoomed in on that enhancer that I briefly mentioned that's in the middle of that big gene desert. This is blowing it up fairly large. You can see this, it is a super enhancer region. These are multiple histone marks over about 40 kilobases or more. And this particular one here is the first place where you get marking as the cells go into DN2A. And it's also where you can see actual chip binding of the Notch transcription factor, GATA3, TCF, even PU1, and RUNX gets into the act as well, all here. So we had previously shown that this peak right here could act as an enhancer if you isolated it and attached it to the BCL11B promoter. So we deleted this region then and asked what difference that would make for the activity of that allele. And I have to say that we were a little bit disappointed at first, and then we realized we had gotten a great gift, because this is a super enhancer. It's not just one enhancer element, and we knocked out one enhancer element. And the beautiful thing is we saw phenotype. We saw phenotype that we would never have been able to see without single cell methodology. And so I just think this is something you can savor and think about doing with other things. So what we did was we knocked out the enhancer from the yellow allele and left the enhancer intact in the red allele and compared that with the parental version where both alleles were intact. And just to remind you what the developmental onset of expression of the version of BCL11B is, where you have yellow and red and they're both intact, again, they go from both off to both on. They go through a phase where you can activate one allele before the other, but it's symmetrical. It's obviously symmetrical. Our staining isn't exactly symmetrical, but you can see that about 14% of the cells activate red before yellow, and 14% activate yellow before red. Now, if you look at the mutant that has this enhancer sub-element deleted, you see something very different, which is the red allele now is intact, the yellow one is crippled. And the yellow one is not totally down for the count, as you're going to see, but it is grossly delayed. If you look in DN2, instead of seeing symmetrical activation of the two alleles, you see basically the same exact percentage of the red allele going on that it would have done in the wild-type case, but now none of them have yellow yet. And the yellow will eventually come on, presumably because it's using those other enhancer sub-elements, which work apparently a little later. But They can't catch up. And so by DN3, when 90% of the controls are double positive expressing, this is really basically only 50%. And eventually, they'll squish it up to maybe 60%, maybe 70%, some animals 80%. But essentially, they will not get, a lot of the cells will never get this yellow allele on. And they'll go out to the periphery, often with just one allele on. And this percentage difference is really dramatic. It is worth noting again that this activation process is working stochastically to control the all or none probability that the gene will go on, not the level. Because you see that those cells that do turn on the yellow here turn it on at exactly the same amplitude as they would have if they had the wild type allele, or not, if not exactly within error. Whereas a lot of the cells never turn it on at all. And I'm just pointing this out because if you were to look at, if you were just to grind up this population of cells and ask, is BCL11B expression effective, you would never see it. You have perfectly wild-type expression from one allele, and you have one-third of the cells not expressing the other allele. That would make a 16% difference in the amount of BCL11B being expressed in the cells as a population, and you would never know that it was an all-or-none effect of the alleles in individual cells. So this is a summary of what we know from this regulation, then. It has combinatoriality as a requirement to get the correct cell type specificity for BCL11B activation and to get the right stages set up more or less. But the timing is not set exclusively by the transacting factor availability. The cis regulatory machinery that opens the locus is so slow that it actually takes multiple cell cycles, multiple days, 2 days on average, to get the gene to open. And so you are actually not reading out the impact of much of the regulatory state that was established in the cells until several days later. And this system with the switch-like behavior of locus opening is actually a very good way to allow this commitment gene, BCL11B, to be hard to turn on but easy to keep on. Once it is on, it's very hard to turn off. In a few minutes, I'll tell you the first way that we found it can be turned off. But for the most part, once it's on, it's on. And this is what it has to do as a commitment factor. Now, this is one story, but I want to go beyond this because you are a single-cell audience and you're sophisticated and you want to know what you can do with this. And one of the things that was wonderful was that Haoyuan Kuei is actually originally a computational systems biologist before he ever got interested in gene regulation. And so he really wanted to model the way that whether or not we really could explain the kinetics, specifically in terms of the way this slow cis-acting mechanism was integrating with the need for other trans inputs, like, for example, the notch input that I told you is still affecting likelihoods right down to the end. And he basically made several fairly simple models simply to ask, if you have one rate-limiting trans input in addition to the cis, where is it plugging into the system? Are all the trans inputs being applied upstream of these cis-acting allele-opening, slow, creaky machineries? Or are you actually getting a change in the state of the cells so that they have more of a particular trans activator available at the same time that this slow, creaky cis machinery is going on, so that essentially you need the trans factors to be newly activated, newly refreshed, in order to read out the current accessibility state that's been permitted by the cis process. And the straw horse in all of this is a case where there is no more trans factor at all involved. And basically, we used our quantitative imaging data, longitudinal imaging data, to do several tests, which actually are different from each other. And the fact that they converge on an answer is not trivial at all. It's actually very satisfying. So first, there's the kinetics of appearance of cells that have activated one allele versus two. It turns out that you can actually, if you make these models and you actually try to calculate the best fit parameters for the cis opening rate constant and the trans activating rate constant in these different topologies, you can come up with predictions for when cells should turn on either one of the single alleles or when they should turn on both of the alleles. And it turns out that this model gets excluded because it predicts that the second allele turns up too late. So we're really down to these two, and where the question is, are all the trans inputs put into the system in order to get the cis opening to go, but then the cis opening automatically allows the gene to be active, or do you actually have a separate need for the trans, for new trans factors in addition to the cis process to read out the results of the cis process? And you can tell those apart two ways. One of them is by perturbing one of your candidate trans inputs, and the notch signal was one that we looked at. The other is by looking at the frequency of different allele activation states generated among the progeny of individual cell clones. Now, the individual cell clones is a little easier, I think, for most people to understand, and that's the only one I'm going to show you. An individual cell that's a founder of a clone comes in with two copies of the BCL11B gene. If they are both naive, then both of them have a chance to get activated in the time span of the experiment, say 4 days. If the time constant for opening is very slow, one or the other or both of them might have already started the opening process, but you don't know it yet. You're sorting them for the fact that you don't see BCL11B being expressed, so you don't know whether there's a secret state underlying that. And the question is, if there were, what is the chance that you would have one allele having a head start over the other, and that you'd have time to get the two alleles activated in this time course of the experiment? And basically, if you, I'm sort of diagrammatically showing you what we're predicting. This would be the case if an individual cell as an input to this actually had an unseen advantage for the red allele. And so by the time you stop the experiment, which is after a limited amount of time, you might see that not all the cells might have turned on any BCL11B, but the red would be on in all of the cells that would have turned on the gene at all. On the other hand, you might have another clone that had the yellow ahead of the red. And this is an example where it not only had the yellow on ahead of the red, but the red came on in the process of the culture. And so there was enough time both for the yellow to be on in all of the cells and in the and for the descendants of one of the daughters of the clonal precursor to also then go on and turn on red so that you now have orange cells coming out, okay? And so this would be one where yellow had the advance, but there was time for the red to turn on after the clone had been established. And then this is one that's actually a very interesting case. This would be a clone in which neither of the alleles was necessarily on yet, or that there was or that the length of time involved was very short for actually opening it. So there was time for yellow to be on in some of the go on in some of the cells after the clone had divided, and for red to be picked instead in some of the cells that had not activated yellow, had not started the activation process of yellow. So this would be a clone in which you got single reds and single yellows without actually going through a nested process where one allele was already open. And it turns out that the two different models give completely different predictions for the likelihood of this type of clone. You get, for this type of input, you get a lot of cells with singles, either singles all by themselves or singles with some double expressors, whereas this model predicts very few. And in fact, we could do this experiment. We could look at the clones, look at their progeny, and it turns out to be quite obvious that the clones are, if anything, even more biased against this kind of independent activation of the two alleles than we even expected from our model in this case. So what that says is that it's a strong preference for Model 3. What's important about Model 3? Model 3 says that the cis-acting state is a constraint on the activity of the transcription factors that are going to come in, at least one transcription factor. But it says something else, too. Because the rate constants for opening the alleles are different by a factor of 5 between the two models. And essentially, this model, the winning model, requires that the length of time it takes for the BCL11B locus to go from initiated to fully open can range on the order of 4 to 6 days. That's longer than the length of time of the culture experiment. And that essentially forces some of the opening initiation to occur back in the DN1 stage. So this basically supports what I was showing you in a different way by the timing of the windows of sensitivity to deletion of some of the positive inputs for the BCL11B gene. It's saying, even though this doesn't depend on that, it's saying that the GATA3 and TCF1 windows of sensitivity back in the ETP state might have been exactly when the cis opening process began, and that we simply couldn't manifest it until 4 to 6 days later when the cells were phenotypically DN2. So is this really true, am I just using these arguments? And if so, what genes in the ETP stage then make the difference for starting this activation process? First, I'm just going to show you that it's true. The way we know it's true is by a totally different kind of experiment where we basically take the cells, use our landmarks for their differentiation, and we ask when BCL11B comes on by plating the cells, again, in this permissive culture system. But we can now include not only live imaging of the cells as they're turning it on, but we can also relate it to time lapse with a cell cycle counting, and we can ask what is actually being conserved in the system. Is there actually such a stochastic behavior going back into the ETP stage? Now, the experiments I showed you up till now were starting with cells right here, poised on the brink of turning on BCL11B. But in order to ask whether there are other sources of variation, we have to go back to the cells that are the precursors of those, several cell generations further back into the ETPs. And to get this to work, actually, we had to play with the biology of the system to make it possible to allow the cells to go through many more cell divisions over a much longer period of time. And we could still track at the clonal level how individual cells were first going through this milestone and then going through this one. And the notion is that if this is a noisy process, then essentially there will be a lot of variation in this that may actually show up as variation even in the lengths of time between when the cells cross this boundary and when they actually turn on BCL11B. And then we can analyze the gene expression basis of this by single molecule FISH and RNA-seq. And so there's a very lovely technique for looking at cell cycle counting, which many people use in hematopoiesis, if you're not familiar with it, where you essentially dye the cells uniformly with a cell surface dye that doesn't come off, and then allow them to dilute it out at each cell division, and then look at it by flow cytometry. And you can actually see the cells starting at a high dye intensity, and then watch them go through sequential twofold dilutions of the dye. And you can look at time versus dye intensity. This is the dye intensity track here. I'm sorry that it looks kind of cut off because of this rim. And you can put that again, you can ask at what cell cycle do other things happen by doing a multi-parameter flow cytometry and comparing it, say, with the timing of onset of CD25 expression, that's the DN2 marker, or BCL11B expression. And so here what you're looking at is CD25 expression, and here you're looking at BCL11B expression. And we're starting now not with CD25 positive cells, but with ETPs. So they first have to turn on CD25. And here's the CD25 going up, and you see that happens pretty fast. So it's basically almost 50% on already after one cell division. But there's no BCL11B on at all in these cells yet. Day three, the cells have gone through one, two, maybe three, two and a half more cell divisions. And they have now, most of them are now CD25 positive, and they're going to be almost all CD25 positive by day four. But BCL11B is still not really on at all. BCL11B starts to come on at day four. And so you can see that this is the lag I was talking about. These are the same populations of cells that are starting from ETPs. They have to get through from ETP to DN2, and then they have to get to BCL11B. And this is telling you that they have to go through more cell divisions and more days to do it. But the question is this constant or is this variable? Is there room for the stochastic noise that we're talking about that we're postulating being involved in this epigenetic slow opening process? Can we actually see evidence of that here? And so for this, what Mary did was, Mary Yui in my lab, was she bred mice that have the BCL11B yellow reporter on a very, very lovely membrane-bound tomato expressing mouse strain. So you can see beautiful segmentation of the cells. And then we can put them into the micro wells to image at clonal densities. So we can now image the offspring of the individual clones confined in these little micro wells. And we can look and see how they turn on in individual clones, comparing within a clone and then between clones, how much variance do we see. And this is just an example of some of the pictures where we're false coloring the beautiful tomato as gray, sadly enough, because they are really beautiful when you see them in red. But this is one cell. After 66 hours, they've divided a lot. You can see that they've turned on this membrane marker that defines them as DN2s. Here, by the 66-hour point, almost all of them are now positive for that. But it takes till 160 hours before you're seeing the nuclear BCL11B YFP stain, which is this false color cyan. And so you can sort of see that you can score this. And the point is that you can look at individual clones, and you can ask, when do the cells begin to turn on CD25, and when do they begin to turn on BCL11B? And what you can see is that there's an offset in the times between them, as I told you. But the interesting thing is this is really a pretty noisy offset. It's a pretty wide range. And essentially, the range is from 3 days to 6 days difference. And so essentially, although the cells are in the same developmental pipeline, and they're basically becoming CD25 positive at the same time, there is this noise affecting BCL11B. This part's important because it says that the ETPs in our population were basically ready to go to DN2. It's not that you had a whole waiting line of ETPs, you know, with some of them much retarded in getting through DN2 compared to the others. They were ready to go, but they took variable lengths of time to get to BCL11B activation. And so that says this slow process is there. So what could be setting up the difference between ETPs whose descendants turn on BCL11B fast and those that turn it on slowly? And here we finally come to RNA-seq and RNA expression analysis. And the question is, what genes in the ETP stage are going to make the functional difference between fast and slow differentiation? Now, this seems totally trivial. We know how to look at diversity among cells. We just throw them into the 10x, or we throw them onto the C1, and we just do RNA-seq. But there's some issues here. One is that the ETPs, as a group, had been poorly characterized because they're really defined by their lacking of any T cell markers. And so there's always a question of whether you're looking at T cell precursors exclusively or whether you're looking at other hematopoietic progenitors in there. The other thing is this emphasized word functionally. We're not interested in cell surface markers. We're not interested in molecules that are involved in metabolic processes, except to the extent that we actually think that they are affecting the long-term fate of the cells, starting from that moment. What we really are interested in is transcription factors, and to some extent signaling transducers. And that the emphasis on transcription factors means we can't afford to do a shallow RNA-seq. With a shallow RNA-seq, you can get very good discrimination between dissimilar types of cells, but we're not looking about dissimilar cells. We're trying to ask, what are the regulators within a continuous developmental process that determine the speed with which a cell is going to go through that process? And so we basically had no choice but to look at low copy number RNAs, which include a lot of transcription factor coding genes. And also, we have to deal with this microheterogeneity problem, and are they only in this transition? So what we did was we basically looked at all of the cells across the ETP to DN2A transition, used the first BCL11B positive DN2Bs as sort of the terminus of the process, and tried to look at what the cells are. And we used, in addition to single cell RNA-seq on a C1, on a Fluidigm C1, we used a very useful technique that in the version of it that was developed in Long Tsai's lab, which is he calls SeqFISH. It's sequential hybridization with multiple in situ single molecule in situ hybridization probes, in which the identity of the gene is encoded by the sequence of colors in which it's detected in one hybridization after another, after another, after another. So you basically have four rounds of hybridization with five channels of color in each one. Actually, we throw in a fifth round just to have over a little bit of extra information in case we have to have bad data points. And the images can be aligned well enough to decode the individual transcript identities. That has taken a little bit of work, but it actually works. And so you can use this to define individual transcripts identities in the same cell by the sequential hybridization method. And you do it not, we've done it not with 10,000 genes, we've done it with 65 genes that were carefully curated to include most of the important transcription factors that we know about in this process, plus other markers that are very important to situate the cells in different lineages. And this is an example of what it looks like in a heat map, a clustered heat map from Surat. And basically the color scale goes from purple low to yellow high on a Z-score scale. And we've basically aligned the clusters according to their order in development. And I think what's very beautiful is that at the single cell level, this is 8,000 cells, which you can process quite easily using this SeqFISH approach. And it's almost sort of approaching 10x-like numbers. But with this very nice low transcript copy number sensitivity. And here you can see some of these gene sets that encode regulatory genes that I was calling phase one genes before. You can see that they're on in the early cells and then they go off afterwards. Here are the genes that are involved in the identity of the T cells coming on at this phase two and then really peaking, not on at all in the early stages. Interestingly, you can split the process up. You can see that there's a third group of these genes in the middle that's intercalated. And this is a very interesting set of genes that have really not been studied very much. Many of them are also shared between T cells and a related type of lymphocyte called innate lymphoid cells. And they include many genes which are actually repression targets of BCL11B. So these are the genes that BCL11B itself, when it comes on, will shut off. And also, if we look much later in development, we can see the genes that come on when the cells actually become selected through their T cell receptors. And you can obviously arrange these very beautifully in TISNI plots. And this is also principal component analysis, which is very good here. It's a size normalized principal component analysis that turns out to be important with this single molecule FISH. And you can see again the continua, even in the TISNI plot, you see that breaking it into different groups is almost arbitrary because it's really defined by the continuum except for this one out group, which is after T cell receptor is expressed. And so here are the genes, and so we can see that the progression is going this way, but very interestingly, we can actually make inferences about the regulators of the genes that we care about. Here's BCL11B, purple, 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 yellow, it comes on, and now it's on. And the question is what goes along with it, and it's two things that go along with it, actually to a large extent, are RUNX1 and GATA3. You can see that increases in both of them actually accompany BCL11B expression. But we can also see genes like PU1, which seems to have the opposite pattern of being high and then going down as BCL11B comes up. So the last bit of this story I want to tell you is how much deeper can you go than this? And I think this is an approach that was really kind of popularized also by Ilya Shmulevich at the Institute for Systems Biology, really to look at pairwise combinations of these transcription factors to try to infer things about their collaboration or their antagonism. And one nice feature is that whether we're using this sort of sparse but deep C1-based RNA-seq, single-cell RNA-seq, or whether we're using the RNA FISH, we basically get concordant results. And this did not need to be true, but it is true. And so if you accept a sort of a background threshold cutoff for these genes in the single-cell seq FISH, it basically has the same pattern elements as in RNA-seq, except that it's much easier to get data from thousands of cells quite easily. And what I'm showing you here is that here's GATA3 and TCF being positively correlated with BCL11B in both. And here's PU1 negatively correlated with it. But you can see that there are cells you cannot get away from that have plenty of PU1, not the highest level, but clearly PU1 is there with BCL11B. However, this is a gene which really is not expressed with BCL11B, LMO2. And we had never taken LMO2 seriously at all before because we knew it was a gene that was only expressed in the earliest ETPs. And we knew that BCL11B doesn't come on until DM2. And so why would a gene that's only expressed in the earliest ETPs have anything to do with BCL11B coming on days later? Well, I just told you BCL11B may come on days later, but it's regulated by events happening in the early ETP. Could LMO2 have anything to do with when the cells become permissive for BCL11B expression? And this is just to show you that again, that basically there's a very complete exclusion of cells expressing both, much more than BCL11B versus PU1. And so I wouldn't tell you this except for the fact that we've done the experiment. And it turns out that if you take cells that are starting T-cell development, they've gotten into DM2, and now they're about half of them have turned on BCL11B. And now you transduce them with genes encoding various phase one regulators or T-cell differentiation antagonists. And you ask, what can you do to take BCL11B down again? PU1 has a lot of effects on the cells, but it doesn't knock down BCL11B. And it's very interesting because PU1 can actually try to make them go off to become macrophages, but it doesn't get BCL11B to go off. And ID2, which is a powerful antagonist of the E proteins that T cells need later in development, is having effects on the cells, but it's not knocking down BCL11B. But LMO2 knocks down BCL11B. And you could say, okay, what if LMO2 is just killing all of the cells that have graduated to this stage and it's sparing these cells? So what we can do is we can take these mock transduced cells at day 10 and then do this infection all over again. And we can take and these cells are now 90%+ BCL11B positive. And again, PU1 doesn't do anything to the BCL11B expression. This is just the vector control. ID2 is downregulating CD25, but the DN2 marker, but it's really doing a poor job of affecting BCL11B. But again, the LMO2 is really significantly downregulating BCL11B. So, and it does it much more so if we add the partner that it works with, which is LYL1. So what I wanted to tell you tonight is a number of stories related to the regulation of BCL11B. I think there were a couple of interesting surprises in here, and there were a number of parts of this story that we could not have learned without using single-cell methodology. BCL11B was interesting and worth going into in this depth because it's not only the best reporter for T-cell commitment at the single-cell level that anyone has discovered to date, but it's also functionally required for commitment, and so it's worth study. We know that there's stringent criteria for activation of the gene, but that it's easily maintained. We know that part of the requirement is the combinatorial T-cell transcription factor requirements for activating it, but there's also this extremely surprising, very slow kinetics of activation, which gives an offset between the administration of at least some of the regulatory inputs and the actual eventual output of BCL11B activation when some of these late arriving inputs, like whatever RUNX is around in the cell and whatever notch signaling is around in the cell, can finally act on the opened alleles. And finally, the last thing I showed you is the first evidence that the initiation of the opening of the allele in the first place, if you go right back into the early ETP compartment, may not only depend on positive regulators, but it may also depend on the shutoff of this negative regulator, and that this is multiple days and cell cycles before activation. What we've basically done is we've argued that the regulators may not be correlated in time with the regulated, but they may nevertheless be tremendously powerful for actually producing the developmentally required expression pattern. And so let me just call out the people that did the work I told you about today. The two-color story was basically entirely due to Haoyuan Kuei, who's now a faculty member at the University of Washington, and a student of his who was supported by the California Stem Cell Project, Kenny Ng, who did a lot of the work under Haoyuan's supervision. The work on the timing of commitment and the cell biology of commitment for about 10 years in my lab has been spearheaded by Mary Yui, and she's also the person who basically allowed and made the changes that enabled us to actually track BCL11B activation from ETPs. Shun was the person who did the LMO2 functional assay at the end, and Wen Zhou is the graduate student who's been wonderful in getting the single-cell RNA-seq and seek fish up in our lab. And we've had marvelous collaborations with Barbara Wold and her lab, especially Brian Williams, Long Tsai, Michael Elowitz, who was the co-mentor of Haoyuan when Haoyuan was at Caltech, and then wonderful people who have helped us with the mice and with the scoring of the many, many imaging and shots. So thank you very, very much for your attention. I'm sorry if this is a little long, and if you have the stamina for asking some questions, I'd be thrilled to try to answer them.
Okay, so we're gonna try to run the microphone to people when they have questions. And I have one question because of the Long Chi seek fish versus the RNA-seq. Mm-hmm. It didn't look like you were just capturing more of, say, the GATA. It looked like it was a huge population of positive cells by seq fish and just not at all by RNA-seq. And is that the level of reads just makes you blind to that level? You're just never getting above your threshold?
Well, our experience, and I think Barbara Wold has much more experience with this and Brian Williams, at low copy numbers, there is a dropout rate with our single-cell RNA-seq. And I think it's not as bad as it used to be. But we're doing Fluidigm C1 whole little RNA-seq libraries there, and we're sequencing fairly deeply.
So even with the C1 going deep, because the dropout that Long's claiming for the RNA-seq is only 10 or 15% at worst. So that's a real selling point.
Right. Now there is a problem. The seq fish does have some background. I mean, you'll have a count of two in a cell that doesn't have the RNA sometimes. You'll have a lot of cells that don't have any counts, but you can't really be sure that a count below five is really a count. So that is a caveat with it. But it is much better, I think, and more reliable at picking up expression in the range between 5 and 20 copies per cell than what we've seen so far with, say, Brian Williams' expertise with the single-cell RNA-seq.
Okay, fascinating talk. Thank you very much. If I understand you correctly, you have a dissociation between the presence of the positive transcriptional regulators and the opening of the chromatin, right?
And the success, the completion of the opening of the chromatin.
Right, and so who is directing the opening of the chromatin to this locus at that time? Do you think there are other transcription factors that then recruit the demetallases that are not the GATA3 and other positive regulators of PCL11B?
I think the GATA3 and TCF and Notch and maybe RUNX as well at that early stage are creating a beachhead. And you can see them binding early on to this cis-regulatory element that we know about for BCL11B as well as some other sites. I think that the beachhead is not equivalent to functional opening. And that's the part, and it's that conversion. It may be a looping that's slow. We know from work, beautiful work that Case Murray has done, further developing the story from what we published on it a couple of years ago. He's actually shown there's a link RNA that comes off of that super enhancer locus, and that's functionally, he has no kinetics, but he has a functional requirement for that link RNA to actually induce repositioning of the BCL11B locus from the nuclear periphery to the center, and also the looping depends on it as well. It probably also depends on demethylation. So those might be on autopilot once the process is underway, but it might be slow as long as you have this reader-writer cis-crawling business going on. We think that the RUNX, and certainly there's some role still for Notch, all the way through till the locus is on. So I'm not saying that they're not still playing a role. I'm saying just that they cannot turn on a locus, even though they're there in the cell, they cannot turn on a locus that hasn't gone through this slow cis-opening process, which depended on an earlier activation by GATA3 and TCF, and possibly the loss of LMO2 as well. Yeah, thanks.
Hi, I've been asked to say my name also. So I'm Alex Sakel from Stanford. And
wonderful, thanks.
That was really awesome,
thanks.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I had a couple of questions on your the single molecule FISH. Do you have to fix and permeabilize the cells?
Yes. Oh, yes. Sadly, yeah, they're not, they can't crawl around anymore.
And then is the resolution good enough to get, like, localization information, like, within
totally.
The cell?
Totally. You're seeing, those dots you're seeing are messenger RNA molecules. And actually, we're doing most of the detection in this SeqFISH methodology by hybridization chain reaction. So for that, you basically have to do digestions and to get rid of the DNA. But you can also do this by another SeqFISH protocol, which is an adapter SeqFISH protocol, where you don't need to degrade the DNA. You just melt off the first rounds of hybridization. And in that case, you actually keep the nuclear transcription factories intact, and it's unbelievably beautiful. You can actually separately measure de novo transcription from the transcription factories and the accumulation of the RNA in the cytoplasm.
You can actually do that with HCR2. It's just Long Chi doesn't like to, for reasons
he doesn't
I can't
like
figure
to. Okay.
Out.
Okay. Well, no, but
so
it's a brighter signal. It's a brighter signal.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, he can also do it with the intron probes, I think, for that. But the other thing is, you can of course come back with antibodies and see exactly what the phenotype of the cells were. And one of the cute parts is little things where we know the P1 protein has a really long half-life relative to any other reasonable transcription factor in the universe. And so this is the one case where there's a dissociation between the RNA going down faster than the protein. You can actually see it in these cells, yeah.
Other questions?
Great.
Can I ask one more?
Sure,
I'm Scott
absolutely.
Fraser. And we should try to say our names because a lot of us are new to the meeting, and that way we'll get to know who each is. Oh, you're up there. You can ask a question.
Good.
Hi, thanks. Salil from MIT.
Great.
Saying our names.
Greetings.
Nice to meet you. There's an emerging hypothesis at our institution, at least, that part of what super enhancers might be doing is nucleating enhancers into phase transition regions
yes.
where, you know, they can really drive transcription to a high degree. And I was wondering if what you thought about that possibility for BCL11B, particularly, you know, with this lag in time you see and with deletion of an enhancer changing, you know, the kinetics,
yeah,
but not the amount of activation at the locus.
Yeah, I think that sounds very nice from this point of view, because basically the phase transition is this all or none thing. We haven't published our DNA fish studies, but we have them as well. And it's quite obvious that the locus repositions and it also changes its looping behavior. This enhancer complex is quite extensive, and there are a number of other sites as well. BCL11B is one of those genes that's turned on in many, many different developmental contexts. And so we started small with a traditional definition of a minimal enhancer, like something out of the 90s, like something that actually drives cell type specific transcription. But in fact, I think that the results we're getting are far more consistent with what you're talking about, and that each element that you take out lowers your probability of causing that phase transition. This happens to be the element kind of sweetly, because these were the criteria we used to focus on it, which is involved in the earliest activation. So what you're losing is the earliest component of the activation, but you still have the later possibility. Yeah, so I think that this is actually probably a very good example. And with 850 kilobases, it's really, really easy to visualize the loops. Yeah. Yeah.
So can I ask something that just doesn't make sense to me?
Please, yes.
And that is, in the cell division plots, there were populations that seemed to appear. You had the double positives and then some single positives or double negatives and then single positive. I mean, the trajectory through didn't make sense.
This is the cell trace violet experiment?
Yeah, the cell trace one. And then the other thing was in the principal component analysis, it seemed like the numbers were put up there at random. I mean, it was like a really bad game.
That's the way the software numbers them. The software.
Yeah, but even if you look at the numbers, it's like DN2A and 2B weren't near one another.
They were. DN2A and DN2B are very different transcriptionally. They look like no difference at all in terms of surface markers, but they're eons apart in terms of gene expression.
Well, then they would be different in the PCA.
They are different in the PCA. This is an easy one to find. Let me just get this up here for you. Okay, so here you're talking about the DN2As up here, and then this, and then the fact, where's the DN2B on this one?
It's not even on the same plot.
Oh, no, I'm sorry, this wasn't marked.
It's so far away, this wasn't marked.
That's terrible.
But there's a lot of them. I'm assuming it's one of the DN2.
So what we're calling them is we're calling them BCL11B positive DN2s. And I'm not, because these cells for this analysis were sorted in order to try to minimize the number of DN2Bs.
Yeah.
We were really trying to get more information about these cells here. And so these cells are not part of a continuum. What happened was we actually, as an outgroup, sorted DN3s and mixed them in at something like a 10% or 20% level.
So that's why the 7 zeros and 1s
are
over
there.
Yeah,
that's why this is a discontinuity, and this is, yeah. We don't have the DN2Bs in here because we tried to keep them out. In this analysis, but you have sharp eyes. In other cases where we didn't select the cells so stringently for the high kit, they're there.
Then you find them in.
Yes.
But they're distinct transcriptionally, even though they're related cell surface markers.
Yes.
Okay.
It turns out that it's a very big change in the activations of genes in the cells, and it's very funny because it looks like a trivial, almost missable difference in surface expression markers, and in fact, it's a huge regulatory upheaval. Thousands of genes change expression.
Other questions?
What sharp eyes, though, Scott. Jeez.
Hello.
Oh, I've known him for many years. If you haven't, then you are in for a treat. Yes, I'm sorry.
Really inspiring talk and fascinating data. Thank you. I'm Robert from Toronto. I have a question from Tax Max Lab. Do you think there's a specific epigenetic mark that takes over a large proportion of the rate-limiting step regarding BCL11B?
I think it's probably like the phase transition that Salil was just mentioning. There's a complex of events that are involved with turning BCL11B on. And what I think our data show is that they are applied on an allele-by-allele basis, which may include DNA demethylation, it may include link RNA in production, it may involve a repositioning from the nuclear matrix to the nuclear interior, it may involve just simply removing the polycomb H3K27 trimethylation marks. But we don't know exactly who is in the driver's seat there. But the fact that it is something which is, that the slow step in this whole process, the dominant slow step in this process after the licensing to go on, there's still a dominant slow step that is allele specific. That to us says some compound of those cis elements have to be involved. And I think that, you know, we would dearly love if other people don't do it first, we would dearly love to find out what they are. I think the bigger take-home lesson is that I think a lot of inferences are made about which transcription factors regulate some gene or some genes based on their coordinate expression. And in a developmentally dynamic situation like this, I hope I've convinced you that need not be the case. This is a case where there's a significant offset of days and multiple cell cycles. And these cells could go on turning on BCL11B even if they had totally lost GATA3 in the interim, if they had the GATA3 in the DN1 stage. And that is, so that's actually an example where you could miss GATA3 as a regulator in that case, because you could say, oh, I can knock it out and it still goes on. But it is a regulator. It's just that its role is in establishing probably the initiation of this opening slow process. And so I think it's just good for people to be a little bit more cautious about assuming that you have to have coordinacy of expression in order to have a transcription factor regulate a target. And I mean, an even bigger point is anytime you have AND logic, the target is at the intersection of the two regulators or the four regulators. It's not equivalent to either of them. And those are really important lessons, I think, for all of us who are trying to infer gene networks up from bottom up like this. Yeah. Thanks for the fabulous questions. I think we should. Yeah?
I think you should take us to the bar.
I think so, yeah, right.
Is there any other questions? Okay, well,
thank you so much.